last 1 year, we've come a long way, and we do hope we'll be able to get new insights. And primarily, our objective is to look at signal processing and machine learning as applied to mouse brain data. We come from signal processing and machine learning backgrounds, and as I said, we have taken a set of activities that we have pursued. One is spike train inference from starting from single neuronal data to populations of neurons, and then we have also looked at diarization of marmoset conversation. So these are the various things that we have done. The first task that we have done is looking at spike train inferences from calcium phrases. We've used some signal processing technique which you are very familiar with. And then we have looked at, again, signal neurons, finding the receptor field of a neuron given the neuronal traces. Then we've also tried to attempt something where we feel that the neuron is like a, the neuronal signatures are actually compressions of the input stimulus, and can we use it for video classification using neuronal signatures as features? And finally, using populations of neurons, these are different kind of imaging techniques that are used. The first three are based on calcium imaging, with the parallel, first one is with parallel electrodes that are there, and the other rest two are from Ringanka's lab on two-photon imaging. And then last one is on mapping different visual areas of the brain that's based on wide field imaging. And of course, diarization of marmoset conversations, also the data has been obtained from the lab. What I'm going to do is, although there are so many tasks, I'm only going to focus on the first and the third one. The rest of them, there are posters. The first one, we have a paper at ICASP. The rest, that's not there in the posters. All the other talks are there in the posters, so I encourage you to go and look at the posters. So the motivation for spike train inference is primarily that it's a fundamental brain activity. Spike trains positions are used for a large range of high-level retrieval tasks. That's what we believe. And so the generally, for example, what is done is you have an electrode, that microelectrode that sits on the neuron and picks up the action potentials. And alternative to this, the other day, Mrigankar talked to us about it, where they have a two-photon imaging, where it's kind of non-invasive. And what you see on the right-hand side is actually neurons which are lit up, and we're looking at single neurons and the corresponding spike train. Can we infer the spike train from these calcium traces? That is the fluorescence of the neuron when it fires, for example, when it's injected with a calcium indicator, it fluoresces when it does firing, as all of you know about it. And the idea is, can we infer the spike train? So what do we do about it? There are a number of existing techniques. There are model-based techniques, which are physiological models, template matching, Bayesian inference, deconvolution. And the primary limitation that we found in these techniques was that they were limited by the noise statistics, and they had some model assumptions. But also that data-driven machine learning approaches like the spike-triggered mixture and other simple learning techniques. The disadvantage that we see of these techniques is that we need sufficient fluorescence traces with ground truth data to train, and their performance is limited when you present them with unseen data. So what did we do? We have been experts in what is called a technique called group delay processing of signals in general. And group delay is nothing but the negative derivative of the Fourier transform phrase. And it has, you can process any signal by post-processing using group delay functions. And we have already proved that it has higher resolution. And what's most important is a completely non-model based technique. What we have here is two figures. We have a two-pole system, and this is the magnitude spectrum, and this is the group delay spectrum. The magnitude spectrum is also additive because we're taking the log here, and there's a Fourier phase, derivative of the Fourier phase, and you see that the group delay, the peaks are better resolved, and this is precisely what we're doing. What we did was we looked at the calcium traces, and we found that minus d phi df, this is not instantaneous group delay, d phi df. Okay, so that's what we did, and what we did was we always spend a lot of time in our labs staring at the waveforms. That's what we did, and then we found that actually the calcium trace is having some information about the spike, and then we said we need something which will just emphasize the spike, and that's precisely what we did, and we found that we find this kind of thing in other domains also. In speech, for example, there's an onset, there's an attack, and a decay, and when you look at music, for example, the onset of a note, attack, and a decay. This is a percussive instrument. And you see the calcium signal is an onset, there's an attack. And that's what we look at. And we said, can we look at a signal similar to what we have looked at in other domains and process it in much the same way? And below is the group delay function. And wherever the zero crossing is there, that is where your spike has happened. That's what we do. And I'm going to, this is the algorithm that is there. I'm going to skip the algorithm. Here, what we do is, this is the calcium fluorescence signal. What we do is we perform what is called a symmetrization. So it becomes like a magnitude positive function. And then calcium signal is, of course, a positive function. And then you symmetrize it. Then it looks like a magnitude spectrum. Then you take the inverse Fourier transform. So you get a zero phase signal. Then you take the causal portion of it. Then you do what is called root Kepstrom analysis. And then you get the group delay of the causal portion of the signal, and that is minimum phase. You can prove that. And for minimum phase signals, group delay has this property of giving you high resolution. Then you do a little, some kind of triangulation, and then you get the spike tree. So this is the algorithm that we have developed. There's no machine learning in it. It just simply does pure signal processing. And here is the calcium signal that we have. This is the group delay. This is the triangulation. This is the inferred predicted spike train, and this is the actual ground truth. And we seem to be performing reasonably well. And these are the various. What we did was you treat it like a frequency domain signal. You take the time series, then you just symmetrize it, then it becomes like a magnitude spectrum. Their time. With df by def, all these calcium traces are df by f, right? I'm correct about this. So what we do, then we tried this on five different data sets. These are, it is df by f. Some intuition to that. Well, if you look at, it's the... Okay. You're wondering whether it's not exactly. Well, you can. I can tell you is that to some extent, yes. For example, it's like the derivative of the spectrum gives you the weighted Kepstrom, the Fourier transform, the weighted Kepstrom is your group delay function. So to some extent, you're right. Yeah. So this is what we did, and these are the different data sets. These two data sets are. These are all from the CNRS website. These are two new data sets that have just come up before we submitted this paper. Evaluation measures, we use what we do in machine learning, area under the curve, correlation, F measure, and so on. And what is interesting is, it's not clear, some things, some data sets we are better on recall, some things we are better on precision, but overall, when you look at the area under the curve, if you compare it with the state-of-the-art techniques here, for example, STM, which is your machine learning technique using large amounts of data, I think we're very close. And in fact, in terms of F measure, we're doing a little bit better. And here there is the ROC curve, receiver operating characteristic curve. Green is the group delay, and this is the STM, which is the best technique that's there in the world. And remember, this is a purely signal processing technique, no data driven or whatever, and no model either. It just increases the resolution of the calcium signal. So this was the first task that we looked at. Next thing that we're looking at is scalability of the proposed approach to other indicators. There's something called an OGB. We have got some data for this, and we're trying to figure out how to do this. And we're also seeing that group delay, since it enhances the peaks, can we put it in a machine learning framework like the STM and see if we can get better spike rates. So this was the first piece of work. The next piece of work was to infer this receptor field of a given even neuron. And that is, you can get the neuron traces, so can be determined that. And determining the relationship between videos and multiple neuron data. Let me tell you what this is all about. So there was one experiment which was performed by Jack in Sood lab. The mouse is presented with a sparse noise stimulus, which is a white box on a gray background. I'm not going to talk about this. There's a poster on this. And the box jumps randomly, and you pick up the neuronal signatures, and the idea is to find out if you can determine the receptive field. Is it a correlation between the neuron signal that you picked up and the receptive field of a neuron? And the details of the results are there later. And we found that one particular neuron which we were looking at, which Jack provided us with, actually corresponds to location 4-3. The box is jumping the 20 positions of the of that box, and we find that one position is. That particular neuron was firing quite a lot. Details are again available in the poster. Please go ahead and look at it. This last picture, this is something that we've been working with for almost a year now. One of the things that we were looking at was Rajiv Rikyo of Mrugankar's lab again, what he did was the stimulus that was shown to the mouse was video. There are five different videos of this kind. And he picked up the signals on multiple neurons, between 50 and 80 neurons. And you know, what is very interesting is the sampling rate is 20 hertz or something like that, and you get one sample value for every neuron. The 60 neurons that are picking up this entire video. So we said, can we classify these images using the 60 neuronal outputs? That's what we started out with, because that's terrific compression, and that's what we did. So there are five movies, 40 trials, 160 frames per movie, and there are so many temporal values. And we said, we want to do two things. One is give the stimuli, which is the video, and use the neuronal responses for the videos and classify using the neuronal responses. Can we do that? Another task was, can we do conventional feature extraction? Your usual edge features and so on, and how do these things perform? And so what we did was we tried the artificial neural networks. It didn't work too well. We used convolutional neural networks. So notice this, what we're doing is we're taking all the neuronal responses, giving it like an image, because the convolutional neural network wants an image. Then what you do is there are five classes here. So there are 40 videos that are 14 to 10 presentations. So we gave about 70% for training, 30% for testing, and did the classification. And then they're given us 6 mice data. And there's one mouse which is damn good, which is 99.6. And the others are between 60 and 99%. So we took this mouse and we said, okay, this is a good guy who's actually sitting and listening to this video. And we got, so when you compare it using video edge operators is what we get. And when you do it with the cortical responses, that is also about 99%. And what is interesting is the training time taken for the conventional feature vectors is about 2 to 3 hours, whereas this takes about 10 seconds of training time. I mean, this got us very excited. So we said, let's do, you know, so the whole idea is that means there's a compression that's happening. Can I give this videos, learn this compression transform, and after I compress, does it give me the neuronal signals? So that's the next thing that we have done. We started out with trying to do a regression model, again using neural networks, and then we found that it was not converging at all, primarily because the data size was too large. Then we said, can we do something that people normally do? ECT is a very common thing that's done for image compression. So what we did was we took the video frames and then converted them to DCT. We took the main diagonal and the two subdiagonals. And for those of you who do not know what DCT is very, very much similar to that of a Calhoun and Louvet transformation. The only fundamental difference is that KLT is data-driven, whereas DCT is a data-independent deconvolutor, and it's popularly used. And then we did this, and then we trained a simple neural network to do this. And what is interesting is, so what we try to do is, from the DCT responses, we try to get the neuronal signals, and we found that. And then, of course, since we have the ground truth, we can compare it, and we got a correlation of about 91%. And then we also did same thing. We just said, okay, now that we have these neuronal traces as predicted by the network, can we use them for classification again? And we got, and then we decided, you know, we decided to do away with CNN. We just did an artificial neural network, and that itself gave us about 96% performance. To give you an idea how this looks like, this is the actual output, and the brown is the predicted output for a particular neuron, and you can use this itself to train the classifier if you want. So what we're trying to do now is it possible to scale to different data sets? Other kinds of video, we have what is called a breakfast video data set, where it's making coffee, making tea, and eating cornflakes or whatever. And we're saying, can we use this? You present the model with the breakfast data set. It gives you this neuronal responses. Then you train your network with the neuronal responses and see if you can perform classification. We have some preliminary results which are looking exciting, but I don't want to say anything more because I want to cross my fingers before I speak about it. So that's about what we have done. So basically, they are discriminative and can perform regression tasks. One thing that we are trying to look at is, what is the relationship between DCT and neuronal signals? Because is there something like DCT, like a PCA, is that something really does? Discrete cosine transform. It's a cosine transform, it's a Fourier transform, not exactly like Fourier transform. DCT is very popular in the context of images because it concentrates, it compresses in the time. So what we're doing is, exactly. Very similar, exactly. That's what we're trying to do. We're looking at this. And finally, of course, we are also trying to, as I said, we have this wide field imaging data, again, from the SUB lab. The idea is that this is the map of the brain. Can we get these boundaries as identified, the retinotopic mapping. And again, there is, I'm not going to talk about it. We used some machine learning algorithms, partially, I mean, it's a very interesting way of looking at this data. And again, what we do is we take the traces across time and we're able to do some mapping. There's a poster on this. So let me stop with this. And then, of course, there's this work on diarization, conversation between a pair of marmosets, transcription of marmoset vocalization, determine when a particular marmoset spoke. Again, we got data from the SOAR lab. We've also got data on from NBRC on EEG and speech. We are yet to analyze the data. We're particularly interested in modeling prosody using EEG signals. We are yet to start this activity. And of course, acknowledgement, Mrigangka, for encouraging us. Rajiv Rikhya, I think we owe everything to him because he came here, spent a week, and taught us everything that is done. And, you know, gave us crash lectures on neuroscience. And when I went there, he showed me the experimental setup, how he performs these experiments. Jack Hip, single neuronal data, Ming Hu for populations of neuronal data, for retinotopic mapping, and Jisinder Sharma for the marmoset data. So that's about what we have done, and there are a whole lot of. Yeah, thank you.
Students, just, any questions?
A little follow up on my derivative thing. So the calcium spikes are kind of like integrals of the sodium spikes in a way, because they're slow responses. Well, if you integrate a, I'm just wondering if you have an impulse response, which is, just an attack and decay.
Yes.
So, to the extent that that's kind of like an integral, it would make sense that if you deconvolve it, you get something that's kind of like a derivative. So I was wondering if you did a matched filter, just a Wiener filter, if you took, what do you get?
For example, you have to assume the noise statistics. That's what we're saying. The idea is in group delay, you don't have to do anything.
No, right. No, this is just a curiosity.
No polynomial of any kind.